So another summer league game is now in the books for the Utah Jazz, and things did not go quite so swimmingly as they did the previous game, but this was to be expected. That being said, there were a few bright spots, mainly being Kyle Filipowski. We also saw a bounce back game that was much needed by one Isaiah Collier, and then Cody Williams also maintaining his level of consistency. While there were some bright spots, there were also a couple rough spots in the likes of Taylor Hendricks having a regression game from inside the arc, ironically enough, and along with Tavion Kinsey and Kenneth Lofton Jr. continuing their slump. But we'll get all into that in a moment. If you're new to the channel, hey there, my name is Wraith Hoops. I cover all things basketball. Go ahead and like the video, subscribe, and turn on post notifications. Without any further ado, let's go ahead and get into this one. The Utah Jazz ended up losing against the Clippers in their most recent summer league game, 88-105, which was an absolute thrashing at some points in the game. It got really ugly early on because there were quite a few flubs, a lot of defensively missed rotations, a lot of just poor play on that side of the ball. Offensively, some shots weren't falling. In fact, a lot of shots weren't falling. But you also had a healthy dosage of turnovers from some people and some just poor shooting nights from others, which ultimately culminated in the poor shooting for the night for the Jazz after having a extremely hot shooting night the previous night. Perhaps it's the fact that it's a back-to-back or just the culmination of players that were playing tonight, but they ended up going 30 for 75 from the field, which is 40%. For reference, they ended up allowing 36 for 72, which is 50%. Not very good, understandably. So they did shoot better from three, though. They were 9 of 25, holding the Clippers to 6 of 20. And the most impressive performance, I would have to say, from this game goes to one Kyle Filipowski. Still decisive, still properly making decisions, making the correct read, and also understanding when to attack downhill while also hitting his threes. He looks a lot more comfortable shooting them. He looks a lot more comfortable attacking people and just has a certain level of swagger to him. Now, he was 2 of 4 from three-point range, 4 of 10 overall for the game, and he shot 3 of 4 from the free throw line, had 5 rebounds, 2 assists, a steal, and only 2 turnovers, combining for a total of 13 points in this one, which made him the third leading scorer. As a second come up behind that, we had Cody Williams obviously having a solid game. He was 4 of 9 from the field, 2 of 4 from 3, and he also had 5 rebounds, 3 assists, which was kind of high for him considering how he's performed in other games, to go along with 1 block and 2 turnovers, putting him with 10 points. Interestingly enough, he did, though, have the lowest box score plus minus at a negative 23. Nobody else was within 10 points of him, and the person that was 10 points from him at negative 13 was Max Aubameyang, who came off the bench and played the most minutes off of the bench at 24.5, but also managed to be the second leading scorer on the team with 19. He shot 4 of 9 from the field. He was 2 of 5 from 3. He was also 9 of 12 from the free throw line to go along with 3 rebounds, 2 assists, 1 steal, and he had no turnovers to his name, which was impressive enough. Kenneth Lofton Jr. shot poorly today, unfortunately, in 13.5 minutes. He was 1 of 9. The one shot that he made was very impressive, but the 8 that he missed were not so impressive. He ended up going 0 of 1 from 3-point range. He had 2 rebounds, 1 assist, 2 steals, and 4 turnovers, which tied with Isaiah Collier to lead the team. But interestingly enough, though, in his 13 minutes, he had a box score plus minus of 0. You also saw Babacar come in the game. He played 13 minutes, 2 of 2 from the field, 1 of 3 from the free throw line. He had 3 rebounds, 1 steal, and totaled 5 points with a box score plus minus of a positive 1. Armando Bacot came in and played 15 minutes. He was pretty effective, 4 of 6 from the field. He did have 6 rebounds. 4 of them were offensive, actually. He also had 1 assist, 1 block, and 1 turnover for a total of 8 points and a box score plus minus at a negative 10. Looking at the remaining starters, we had Tavion Kinsey, who also had a poor shooting night tonight, playing almost 27 minutes, going 1 of 7 from the field, 1 of 4 from 3-point range, to go along with 6 rebounds, 1 assist, 1 steal, and no turnovers. However, he did have 5 offensive rebounds, which was impressive enough considering the fact that he plays the guard position. Taylor Hendricks had a regression game. Unfortunately, he was 9 of 10 yesterday, so I guess he just felt like he needed to pay it back today, as we were expecting him to shoot kind of poorly and come back down to earth, because 9 of 10 obviously is not sustainable even for the greatest shooters in the league. I didn't think he was going to go of 2 of 10, which effectively meant that he went 0-5 inside the arc, because he shot respectable outside the arc. He was 2-5. He actually hit his first and last three-point attempts, the first one coming within the first 2 minutes of the game, and the last one coming within the last 3 minutes of the game, if memory serves me right. So, obviously, he just shot very, very poorly in the middle, to the tune of 8 missed field goal attempts. He did, though, hit 2 of his free throws. He also had 5 rebounds, 2 of them being offensive to go along with 1 assist. He led the team in blocks with 3 and only had 2 turnovers, total of 8 points. Box score plus minus of a negative 14. So understandably so, his shooting hurt pretty bad, and the fact that he played 27 minutes and still managed to do that really sucked. Isaiah Collier, though, alongside Kyle Filipowski, I know I said that Kyle deserved the MVP for this particular game, but in my head, I'm very partial to Isaiah Collier. Now, the reason why I say that is because he needed a game. Lately, he's been shooting high single digit to low double digit shot totals, but hitting low, like around 3-for-12 kind of territory. But today, he was 8 of 13. He was still 0 of 2 from 3-point range, so he's still in a drought hunting, looking, I believe, 4 games back was the last time he hit one. He was 4 of 6 from the free throw line, though, had 3 rebounds, had 3 assists, had 2 steals, but he still ended up facing the turnover demon because he tied, as I said previously, with Kenneth Lofton Jr. for 4, which is not something that you want out of your point guard, but nevertheless, it happened. He totaled 20 points and had the second worst box score plus minus at a negative 18, right behind Cody Williams and right in front of Max Abmas, who was the second leading scorer. Interestingly enough, this game doesn't really change too much of what I understood. It just showed furthermore why Taylor Hendricks is inconsistent and why he can give us flashes of something that's amazing and tantalizing, something that we would love to see from him as an individual player, and then completely just pull the rug out from under us while we're sitting here glazing him. Kyle Filipowski, though he did shoot only 4 of 10 from the field, though he did only shoot 2 of 6 from inside the arc, I like his shot selection. I like what he does when the ball's in his hands. I like his decisiveness, and I like his willingness to pass. He did only have 2 assists in this game, but he made a plethora of passes that were necessary. He doesn't necessarily bog down the offense with the shot attempts. Today he shot 10 along with Taylor Hendricks. Obviously, he was doubly sufficient as Taylor Hendricks. And he also ended up being the second leading shooter on the team behind, obviously, one Isaiah Collier. He tied with Cody Williams and Max Abmas as far as field goals went alongside Armando Bacot, who all had 4 apiece as well. But I just like his shot sample size. And so temporarily, he's going to be the crown rookie. Also, considering the fact that we did bag him in the second round is something that I still can't completely wrap my head around because he's coming outright. And obviously, he's not going to be able to play this exact same way once the actual NBA season begins, because that's just not how the league works. It's a whole lot of not necessarily just politics, but also just you have players that are ahead of you on the depth chart. You have guys that have been expecting minutes, are expected to do great things this year, and you're the rookie. You're coming in. You have to prove yourself, and I like how he's finally coming into his own and just really taking that step forward instead of staying stagnant and kind of struggling. Another player that ended up also taking a step forward, I guess they had the same kind of mindset, was a Bronny James, who shot back-to-back solid percentage from the field and ended up managing to score double-digit points. So that's going to be a video that I will enjoy covering. But for us here, as far as the Utah Jazz are concerned, Filipowski's doing his job. Cody Williams showed a little bit of signs as far as being a little bit lackadaisical on defense. And the fact that there were a couple plays where he just got caught ball watching and his man cut to the rim. And yes, this is summer league, so it's not the most important thing, but it's one of those things where I kind of concern myself with that and just kind of take a little mental note of it, because you don't want to have that as a trailing problem going into the regular season, because Keontae George actually had a problem with that. But then again, Keontae George also couldn't stay in front of his man. The fact of the matter is, Cody Williams, when he's locked in, is a very solid defender. When he's playing on ball, he's a very solid defender. So this is just a minor footnote. something to pay attention to and something that he needs to work on, obviously, because you don't want to just give up layups to people that will actually dunk the ball and get the crowd going, get that morale boost for their team and just keep pushing things or just create better offensive opportunities for their teammates. But offensively, overall for himself, I enjoyed the playmaking that he did today. I enjoyed the fact that he was very observant of the court. He was still very decisive in his motions as well alongside Filipowski, and I felt like it ended up paying dividends. Again, he managed to shoot less than 10 field goal attempts and still managed to score double digits. He also had 5 rebounds. He also had those 3 assists, still managed to play well enough without being too turnover prone, which I can greatly appreciate because there's a lot of guys that just won't see that peak of the mountain in their rookie year or in a couple seasons into their career. So, of course, once again, I want to stress this is the summer league, but at the same time, these boys, some of them at least, were hooping, and some of them will continue to hoop. Others of them need to take a bounce back game, maybe a couple games. The main person on the hot seat for me personally right now is going to be Kenneth Lofton Jr. because I'm pretty sure this makes him 2 of 17 over the past 2 games. And if I stretch it out to 3 games, I don't think it gets any more impressive, to be quite frank with you. The fact that he also managed to shoot 9 shots in just 13 and a half minutes and shot this poorly is also a concern because it's like, if you're not shooting particularly well, and the ball's not going your way, do something else that you can be very effective at. And he didn't do a good job of that today in particular. That said, I did like what I saw from Armando Bacot. He's really strong on the offensive glass. He loves to hang around the rim. He loves to put back dunk. He loves to dunk, period. And he will attempt it at any possible opportunity. He also is just a little bit of a strong screen setter. He knows how to roll well, but that's to be expected considering he isn't a one-and-done prospect directly out of college, coming from Chapel Hill. But looking over at the Clippers, Jordan Miller, Kobe Brown, Ray J. Dennis, Cam Christie, and Terry Taylor all shot 50% and up. Ironically enough, those were their starters. You also had Diabate off the bench going 5 of 9. And then Elijah Harkless playing 18 and a half minutes going 3 of 5. So there was a lot of guys that were double-digit scorers. As a matter of fact, they had a total of 6 in this game, which was not fun to watch. And only one person had a negative box score plus minus, and that was Trevor Hudgens. And he played only 12 minutes of the game. So that just kind of told you more or less how this one was panning out. Nevertheless, it's just one game. It's a footnote in the books, and they will continue on. And hopefully there's going to be more progress to be seen before we gear up for the regular season and address some other things, like the fact that Russell Westbrook is back on the Jazz just to get bought out again by the Jazz and apparently go to Denver in the sign and trade deal that sent Chris Dunn to the Clippers, where he finally received his payday. But that's going to be a video unto itself. And as always, it's your boy Wraith Hoops. Thanks for tuning in this video. Go ahead and smash that like button, subscribe, please turn on your post notifications and become a member of the channel or donate to help support the content. With that being said, good morning, good evening, and good night. No matter where you're on the globe watching, thanks for tuning in, and I'll catch you guys in the next one. Peace.